Hello and welcome to episode 1 of Let's Play Civilization 6. We will be playing a new Civ today. I'll go through my Civ selection as I'm actually picking it. So we're not going to resume a game, we're going to create a new game. It's going to be on Immortal. I'm 0.5 on beating it. I've lost one game and beaten it once so far. We will pick standard, game speed, continents map, and we'll go large. And we will be picking Hojo Tokimune. He's one of the stronger civs to play, but some of his abilities we won't be taking advantage of as much. Immortal should be fun to play. The AI gets a lot of build bonuses and stuff, so we would expect early wars, rushes. We might lose just right there, so I don't know if this episode is going to keep going or not, but we'll see. Continents will force us to explore, so we're not like turtling. We'll need to explore and meet new civs, and large just so there's more civs around. This should be a lot of fun to play. Let's give it a shot.
From the first stirrings of life beneath water, to the great beasts of the Stone Age, to man taking his first upright steps, you have come far. Now begins your greatest quest, from this early cradle of civilization on towards the stars. The great wave of Buddhism follows you, Shikan of Japan, Hojo Tokimune. Your people truly understand what it is to practice balance, and even your finest samurai will be well learned and spiritually apt. Be strong, embrace the divine wind, and you will reach enlightenment.
Right, so divine wind's ability, we get extra attack when we're fighting on the coast. Meiji Restoration, we get adjacency bonuses. This is what really makes it really strong. And we get the Electronics Factory, which is a better factory. And Samurai, which is an okay unit. But I think the window is too short for these guys. And also in Civ 6, they do a funny thing where you can't do slingshots a lot of times anymore. Like, I can't build a bunch of warriors and then upgrade them through to swords and then to samurais. I think samurais may not. I think I can upgrade them from swords actually. But some of the other unique units you can't upgrade. I think I was thinking of Teddy's Rough Riders, for example. They're on a separate line from cavalry. So I think samurai might be okay. I can build encampments, holy sites, and theater square districts in half the time. That's really helpful. So we'll give it a shot. Not a bad start on the river, so we should be able to grow fine. I'm just gonna move my warrior here for the first look. Usually my last few mortal games, I've tended to just meet a civ right off the bat, like on turn 2 or 3, so I expect that to happen again in this game. I'm going to risk it and move him one tile, so we save this forest here for later. And then I'm going to build my city. Although what I do sacrifice is I get more mountain tiles, which doesn't really help us because I can't build anything on the mountain tiles. And the other thing is, because of the relative disparity lack of disparity in cost, it's actually much more cost effective to build slingers right off the bat because they can defend themselves, they can double from a military than scouts. So we'll go with that. And because of the movement rules, it actually doesn't help us all that much to have scouts. I think they need to rebalance scouts, make them cheaper, and move faster to make them worth it to build in the beginning of the game. So we have wine, which needs irrigation, so we'll go for that. That's bonus resource. I think that also needs irrigation. So we'll start with pottery and go to irrigation. And we'll try to hit some of these Eureka's. Let's hit, yeah, Code of Laws. I always have to start Code of Laws. Oh, silk. Okay, so that's probably my next city is gonna be around here somewhere. If I can, if there's no civ nearby, that's gonna take the spot. So yeah, as I was saying, it's always been a really crowded start for me. I have not had a chance to play in a relatively open start where I had a lot of room and not a lot of contact. Maybe this will be different, but yeah, I haven't met anyone yet. Should be soon. I think within the next 10 turns, I should meet someone.
Our city-state neighbors have made a request of us.
Okay, trigger inspiration for early empire. That's not a hard one to trigger. I just need to grow a city to size 6. Okay, yeah, and in Civ 6, it's so much harder to. Oh, Mercury. Okay, you're gonna get luxury, so that's gonna be a priority. I'll try to ally them. What's their suzerain bonus? Oh, you're a gold-oriented civ, which is always nice. Yeah. And yeah, in Civ 6, each of the city-states have a unique suzerain bonus. So Lisbon, your trader units are immune to being plundered on unwatered tiles. Okay, that's not too bad. It's not a strong one. I think Toronto is one of the better ones because actually it increases the range of your industrial buildings by 3 tiles, so it makes them a lot stronger. If you have a bunch of cities together, then their factories from further away are going to be able to affect more of your cities. Okay, let's move it here. Oh, another Mercury here. It's interesting that they have Mercury as a luxury resource in this game. Oh, more Mercury. So as I was saying, city-states are a lot harder to keep in this game because in Civ 5, all you have to do was throw in a bunch of gold to keep them on your side. In this game, actually the last game I just won on Immortal, by the end of it, I didn't own any city-states, or I wasn't suzerain of any city-states. I had a lot of envoys in one of them. I was trying to fight off the Spanish, I think, over control, but you know, over 30 envoys in the city, it's just ridiculous. I think that's a little over the top. There needs to be some way to lock it down more, but yeah, so I wouldn't expect to have control over more than one or two city-states on a good day in this game, compared to 5, 10, 15 in Civ 5, which was, you know.
No man ever wetted clay and then left it, as if
Uh,
they.
which was what made diplomatic victory possible in Civ 5, was you could just dump a bunch of gold into city-states and get all the votes. Obviously, you need the economy and the gold for that, but you know, they did take out diplomatic victory in this game, so that's another thing that's different, more luxury. So this a second city here would be nice because we are on the river tile, and they'll have access to here, all these resources here. I don't know. There's a mountain range here. I see a border here. I think that's another civ or a city state. So we might be on a fairly good start in terms of defensive position. They might have to come at us from the sea. Hattusha, okay. I'm always a little bit disappointed that the Hittites don't get the top billing in Civ games. They're in again in this game as a city-state. I don't think they were in Civ 5. They were in Civ 4 and 3, I think, but only as expansion civs. So we'll see if they come out with a Hittite expansion in the future. We'll build a monument. Okay, barbarians. One of the things is I actually find that being closer to another civ tends to make me play a little bit better. Not better as in, not objectively better, but better as in much more defensive play. Because if I'm not near anyone, I tend to just not worry too much. I build too much, or I spend too much time moving things around. Building.
It is not the mountain we conquer,
Oh.
but ourselves.
Building too many districts. Okay, we got that. And not really building the military that I need. And I actually found that the games I tend to do well in is because there was someone nearby and I had to play really defensive and focus on my defenses. Okay, I gotta retreat the slingers. They're not gonna survive this. Yeah. So I had to play a lot more defensively if I'm near someone. So look at this mountain range here. I'm pretty much, my capital is pretty much immune to attack. They have to come around from up here or from up here or from the sea now. So I know I'm in a good defensive position right now. Or they have to come down from down south. Which there's these two city-states guarding it, but you know, they could always take control of them or just attack them and take them over, which is another thing in Civ 6 that's different is in Civ 5 you might have one or two warmonger type leaders who like to take city states.
New policies in our government can be of great benefit.
Oh, okay.
It is not wisdom but authority that makes a law.
So yeah, I still have that new to Civ 6 thing turned on because I need reminders that I can build something or something's available because I don't automatically remember it yet. Oh, that's my first goodie hut. So yeah, as I was saying, in Civ 6, a lot of civs will take over city-states and take them over and make them into their own cities because... because it pays to do that. Let's do this. And we'll do... I like to do the one gold, one faith one because it actually helps me get an early pantheon. And in Civ 6, you get to keep your pantheon even if you don't found your religion. So that's nice. You're not like stuck getting someone else's pantheon. So yeah, in Civ 6, city states are a lot more vulnerable because AIs will take them over. Even if they're relatively peaceful civs, they'll take them over still because they're just programmed to do that. And I don't know if that's going to change in an expansion or not, but that's how it is right now. Okay. I'm trying to find my third city-state because that's going to give me a bonus. Oh, another goodie hat here. That's gonna give me a bonus, which is nice. No luck so far. Let me see, what do I want to do? Let's get a scout going. Some gold.
Thousands have lived without luck.
Let's get some mining going. Yeah, this is a weird game. I was all psyched up, expecting to meet someone right away, but I still haven't met anyone. Bit of an isolated start, I think. So I move this one over here. My guess is there's something here that's we haven't found yet because this barbarian camp in. Yeah, barbarians are a bit of a pita right now, or a pain in the ass. In this game, especially, they're very, very.
It's like scouts are unique.
They're very problematic, to say the least. Okay, let's take it off. I'm gonna get a Eureka here for killing. That's always good. Go straight to archers. Perfect. I guess I'll send him down here. I'm gonna get a builder out. And I'll get another Eureka for killing three barbarians. Oh! There's someone here. Oh, that's a city-state, I think.
When you find yourself in a hole...
There we go, we got our boost. I like this boost because that gets us our Classical Republic, which I like to switch to.
Gilgamesh Kiengi, U Sharuru Kanaku. Latadar, Anaku Ibrija Tibaku.
It's nice to get the Sumerians though, because they do get shafted a bit in Civ. They were kind of like the first civilization. So we can get a campus up. There's Uruk in modern day Iraq. There we go. So this is probably his sphere of influence. I think we're gonna get the don't settle near my lands if we were to take a city here, but I think I'm going to risk it anyways, because this is too good to pass up. And that's going to... I'm going to take this frog cam here. That's our second barb kill. And I'm going to go and hit up this goody hut down here. I'm going to bring down my slingers, so that's pretty much... helps us solve a problem, because I was undecided where I want to send my okay, that's our third barb kill. That should be another Eureka. Oh, not quite dead. Okay, pulling him back. Very nice. This area is actually very nice. There's more stuff here, actually. Here's our third barb kill. There we go. Bronze working.
Without craftsmanship, inspiration is a mere reed shaken in the wind.
Greenery going, and I'm gonna start farming here. Oh, nice. We got a wheel. Tusas. Early Empire. Yeah, we're a bit behind on Early Empire because our starting position tended to not be that favorable for growth, so. Oh, goody hut here. I'll grab that. So I'm going to send the scout now. I'm going to pull back my warrior.
We have recently gained advanced knowledge in city planning.
Writing is easy.
Right, it's just that's telling me that I can build my first district, which we won't get to for a bit. I need to develop my lands first. And pull back my defensive units, because in case barbarians attack, there's going to be barb camps popping up around here. Yeah, even in a late game, barbarians can be quite bad. I had one game where... there was a barbarian camp that popped, like, just outside my border. So, like, my border should be here, and then this would be, like, a no man's land, and then the next civ would be over here. So it's just, like, a maybe five-tile no man's land that's sort of hidden in the fog of war, kind of like this. And a camp popped up, and then it sent a scout, found my borders. This was in the modern era, so there were tanks and stuff. And it just spawned like a bunch of tanks, and like it's like a terrorist state almost. Like, and then it started pillaging my lands. So you can't leave one side of your empire undefended if you have, like, unclaimed land, because barbarians are gonna pop, and they're going to be quite a nuisance in the game. Which I find kind of interesting, because barbarians have tended to be problematic in past games, but this is the one game where I found that they actually seem to be quite interesting as a faction. They're not just like fillers. They're kind of they're around with their own agenda, which is very interesting. Okay, not bad. We got some early boosts. Talk to Gilgamesh. He doesn't like me already. That's one of the things I think they should rebalance for a patch. Is on the higher difficulty levels, the AI tends not to like you very much right off the bat, and that's because you start out with so many disadvantages. Like they have more settlers than you, they have more of everything. So they look down on you very early on, and it tends to skew diplomacy quite a bit, because then you can't really have a normal diplomatic relationship with an AI that doesn't like you from the start. They'll eventually like you in the late game when you've actually survived long enough, but yeah, it's a little bit weird. I don't quite like the way it's set up right now. Because I'm Japan, I'm going to leave some of these spots open, because I know I will be building districts for adjacency bonuses. And I'm going to build my my campus district right here, because all the mountains, that's going to be killer science. So I'm just going to move my builder back in and rest him. Okay, start moving my scout out.
No somos Felipe, rey de España y Portugal. Empero, por encima de todo, somos fieles devotos de la única y verdadera religión.
Where is Spain? Uruk, Preslav. Oh, see. Okay, there we go. Oh, they're all the way up there. Okay. Okay, can I buy a settler yet? Yes. Oh, no, that's building a settler. Can I buy one? No. Okay, I'll save my money for now.
I don't underrate the value of military knowledge, but if men make war in slavish obedience to rules, they will fail.
Still have not discovered a second continent, which kind of sucks.
Sometimes the wheel turns slowly.
Okay, let's get a astrology out of the way. I'm gonna get a water mill. It's gonna help us grow and build faster things, or build things faster, rather. Keep sending them out. I just figured I don't have enough turns to switch to so many units, so I'm gonna rush build that warrior and keep saving up money for a builder later. Maybe I don't need to send him back. Stonehenge is already built. Oh, great, I can build my own Pantheon. What's good here? This might be good because we have wine and coffee, I think, nearby. This is very situational. I had this in my last game, which is great because I started near floodplains and a bunch of deserts. That was very powerful. Yeah, so this is not going to be a particularly strong one for us. This would be nice if I started on the coast. I'll pick this one. Yeah, I think this is the coast right here. There's not much to see, but I'm gonna explore it anyways. And here's our coffee.
Position without a knowledge.
So if I can build a city here, I can grab 1, 2, 3, 4. Are these for luxuries? That's a really good spot to have. I need to get a settler out ASAP. Just chasing this scout down here. Too much inertia. I don't want to move my warriors back. Yeah, this is just a coast. Okay. I guess the Sumerians might be able to move down here too, if the mountain range just ends up here. Oh, another city state. Oh, I was the first to meet them too, which is nice. Early Empire, it's gonna be a while till I get there. Eureka for sailing. Might not happen either. I think I need to build a city by the coast for that. Oh, okay. Well, if we can get something going with the Spanish, that would be nice. Just have a friend early in the game. Oh, come on. Okay, they don't take this. They don't take it. Okay, I see. I was gonna. Okay. I'm gonna rest them here for a turn. See if they move. I'm positioning my units like this rather than turtling in a city just to expand the fog of war a bit out so I have more field of view so I can see what's coming to me. 20 faith. Oh, I could settle here as well if I wanted to. Not a great place, but that's a spot because there are some luxuries down here.
That's the positive aspect of trade, I suppose. The world gets stirred up together.
That is very true. Yeah, Civ always likes to generate all resources in spots like this where no one would settle, but just like one fish. And sometimes you'll see the AI settle there. Okay, we're gonna... Early Empire requires us to get a city to size 6, so building a settler will bring down our pot by 1. So we're gonna delay that a bit just to get a settler up, because I really want this spot here for my second city. And in Immortal, it pays to have... to expand early. So I'm gonna position him where I want to settle, so I kind of have a field of view. See what's going on. Don't get surprised by barbarians.
Bronze is the mirror of the form.
Yeah, I found a city on the coast. Let's do animal husbandry for now. Cheap techs, get them out of the way. I expect to be behind in techs for a long time. Until I can catch up, probably near the end of the game. So once I get the settler out, I want to get a trading unit out. That's the other thing that's different in this game, is trading units are a lot easier to build and a lot more important. And it's not just sending units to trade with other civs, it's actually sending units internally to trade with your own cities to get to boost them early, which is always nice. Because your internal trade routes will tend to give you a lot of food and production. Oh, okay, stone. Keep sending him this way, and then if my warrior can swing back down from up here, I'll be fine. Settler is done. Okay, I'm gonna build the...
My liege, we have an envoy at our...
If there are no dogs in... I like to say I practice...
Okay. Good iron, so that's... My next city is gonna be down here. So who do I want to send envoys to? Commercial hub. What's Preslav? Okay. Let's send him envoys here. I can be suzerain of Hattusha. Found their agenda. Let's check their agenda. Counter reform. Okay, so they probably have a hidden agenda somewhere in there where they don't like people who meddle with city states. Let's get the trading unit out. That's one thing playing on higher difficulty levels is you can get really discouraged by all early wonders that the AIs can build, and it's not really anything you can do about it. It's just how the game is. Okay, I can see that there's borders here, so the Sumerians probably have another city up here. We might not get this coffee because they could easily settle a city down here and grab this, but we just want to be able to grab at least this one. Early Empire. It's gonna be a while. Eureka for sailing.
May the forces of evil become confused while your arrow is on its way to the top.
Oh, that's a mountain range actually, so they're bounded. Interesting. Interesting terrain. I've never seen a terrain quite like this. Send it to Uruk.
In addition to bringing riches to our
currency going, and then I want to build a campus. Okay. I knew they were going to do that. Apologies. Yeah. Okay, so I probably could have saved that trading unit and sent him over to Tokyo and then sent a trader back to Kyoto to give it food and some production to start. That might not have been a bad idea. What do we need here? Save him for now. I would expect them to declare war on us at some point. It's probably not a good start, really. So I think the continent goes up like this, through the lands of the Sumerians, so I have to find a way up here. I'm going to move my scout back up, and moving my warrior back home. But it's nice that I get this little slice down here, pretty much all to myself. Oh, I can check here. There might be a mountain pass here. Let me see here. I should check here. Sumerians are checking us out. I should not get too complacent. I need to build some military soon. I just want the campus up early because a mistake I made in my previous game was I spent way too much time. Damn scouts. It's probably. Yeah, there's a barbarian camp right there. Now they're gonna rush home, and to notify his camp. If he gets back to his camp, we're gonna get an uprising here. Okay, there's no mountain pass, so completely blocked off here. So this side might also, we can might also settle here, but it's going to be hard to move units between these two sides because the mountain range. And that's what I like about Civ is terrain actually plays a huge role. Yeah, appreciate it. The terrain plays a huge role in the development of empires. And funny thing is, before I even read Jared Diamond's Gun, Germs, and Steels, I kind of knew intuitively that a civilization that starts out in the marshes and jungles tend to not do as well because they, you know, there's so many other things going on that makes them not thrive. So it kind of, it's intuitive. You just kind of know that playing a game like Civ. If you start in a jungle terrain, especially in Civ 3 or something like that, your Civ is going to be in a bad position. It's a challenge start, almost, if you want to call it that. So yeah, it's interesting that it's also in this game. They don't have as many jungle starts in this game as they probably did in old Civ. So, but yeah, in Civ 3, if you could literally start in the middle of the jungle just because of the bad roll of the RNG, and yeah, it's always a challenge. Okay. Yeah, they grabbed, they built their third city here. I knew they would do that.
Wealth consists not in having great possessions, but in having few wants.
Let's get to masonry. A settler, I'm not gonna get my early empire bonus. Great merchant. Oh, that's gonna be rough. Defensive tactics. I'm gonna do this. Grab that. Okay, I think, yeah, they're really buying land around me. So I think this is a good place to stop our first episode. Thank you very much for watching. I will see you next time.